Tonight I wanna see the bright lights over me. Show me something magical, something beautiful. Come and take me higher, set my world on fire tonight. Tonight, show me everything I want and more. Take me right around the world. I feel it tonight, got me feeling so right. Yes, I'm a good life.
This week on Top Billing, Queen Bee gets supermodel Andrea Diaconu's secret guide to the best coffee, lunch, and pretzels in New York. DJ Fresh, DJ Milkshake, Somizi Mhlongo, and the guys go toe-to-toe with Thando Thabethe's Netball All-Stars. It's the funniest, most heartwarming wedding of the year, as Springbok flanker Siya Kolisi and his beloved Rachel Smith say I do. 5FM's Nick Hamman and Mad Money Mike relive their campus radio days and how Nick still managed a degree. Actors Stian Bam, Fumani Shilubana and Edwin van der Walt use honest insights to tell a difficult story of fathers and sons. And your presenter this evening, Jonathan Boynton Lee, brings you the show from this award-winning home around a courtyard garden with antiques in every direction.
Good evening and a very warm welcome to Top Billing. Tonight's show comes to you from a Gauteng home with an award-winning design that serves as the perfect showcase for the owner's fascinating collection of all things vintage and antique, but displayed in a way that's ultra-modern and fresh.
This style of architecture became known as Transvaal Modernism. It's not just a self-contained house in the middle of a site, but more, a balanced collection of carefully considered, solid, geometric blocks. When Paul Mrkusic and his partner first saw the minimalist yet sculptural property, they knew it was for them.
At first sight, it almost looks like those old style of architecture, but it's actually quite modern, old school. I love the play on it though.
It's quite retro, in fact. And in fact, this is one of the reasons we loved the house when we saw it, was that it has this plaque, and the architects at the time, Louis Lo, Apostolos and Bergantine architects, built this house and won an award by the Institute of Architects.
Wow. Well, with such rich heritage and culture, I'd also buy this house. Oh, absolutely amazing.
You'll see why. So please come inside, Lorna.
Thank you so much. Gosh, this is really lovely. There's so much to take in, Paul. It's so eclectic, very artistic, but I love how colorful it all is.
That's why we just thought the space was spectacular. It has incredible light, incredible energy, and it's just suited the sort of thing that we collect and our furniture perfectly.
What was it about this house that appealed to you when you bought it?
Well, I think the first thing obviously was the central atrium. I mean, it's the heart of the home,
yeah.
The energy pulse of the space. And it's incredibly tranquil, we find. So if you come outside, you see all the greenery, and it comes into all the rooms as well.
I love it.
The whole house just opens up.
The sleepers are a mark of the railway executive the house was built for. As head of the SA Antique Art and Design Association, Paul's influence is also clear.
Paul, being a buyer of antiques, you must have had so much fun putting the space together.
We had enormous fun, Lorna. I mean, for example, this piece here is one of our favorite pieces. We've had it for a long time, and it was made in 1950.
Wow.
And it's what I call transformer furniture, and each piece is modular and it changes.
Wow.
And again, that's the sort of thing that I enjoy from furniture. This lamp, for example, we bought that from a designer in Cape Town, Laurie Veet, and it's just such a fun, quirky piece that it works well with the collection of the things we've got.
Paul, wait a minute. What is this interesting looking spaceship thingy-ma-bob?
Well, it is a spaceship.
Frisbee.
This is peculiar. If you plug it in,
quite.
It's a fan heater, and it actually
wow.
lights up. So it was made in the 60s, I think, in Holland.
Seems like you also are a lover of art.
We can't stop buying art. In fact, that was one of the reasons we bought this home, was we had art in ceilings, under beds, almost anywhere you can think of. So we moved here and we started to group particular works together that we felt worked. If you look around the room, most of the pieces are quite modern,
yeah.
with some vintage pieces, sort of 1960s.
I feel like a little kid. My eyes are constantly like, what's that? What's that? What's that? There's just so much fun in this home.
It's a treat for the eye. That was what we were going for. Quirky bits. There's a dressmaker's dummy there, little sculpture on the table, the drinks trolley in the corner over there.
So cute.
So it's exciting pieces like that.
Even if your means are modest, in antiques a good eye can trump a big budget.
So in fact, Lorna, this is now another piece that I found at a junk shop, which I love. And again, it's a piece of like, it's a transformer furniture. So take a look inside. I want you to see the detail.
Do you just open it this way?
Absolutely.
Look at that. That's, I didn't realize. That is so unique. I thought it would open the other way.
That's what I wanted you to see. Most people get a surprise when that happens. And in fact, I did when I bought it. And it opens up and forms this incredible bar.
Definitely the coolest thing I've seen in the 21st century.
It's that sort of thing that I love, I must say.
On a sloping site, stepped floor surfaces and corresponding ceiling heights define the various spaces.
This has a wonderful openness to the space, good proximity to the kitchen. So
which is a good thing.
Exactly. We can drink a glass of wine, you can cook, and from the stove you can see the TV, which I love.
That's really lovely. Through each space, it's almost like there's a natural air conditioning throughout the house. If you're sitting here, you can enjoy that side and that side of just natural air, which is beautiful, actually.
You're exactly right, Lorna. In fact, that was the genius of this architect, is that with the atrium and these different spaces, you get this wonderful flow of air through. Yeah. And I mean, when the sunlight, I don't know if you remember how hot it was, but I lay on this couch reading a book, and you just get this gentle flow of air coming through. We spent a lot of time finding these pieces. Each one is special and each one has a story. But in fact, my favorite one is this piece here.
What is that?
I want you to have a look through it, because if you think that virtual reality was invented today, this is something that will make you think again.
Okay.
Do you see it?
It's 3D. It's literally like the guys are popping out at me. That is the coolest thing ever.
I can't get over
this piece. Man alive, that is so cool.
This is actually over 100 years old.
Wow.
And these cards are from the Anglo-Boer War. So in fact, this piece is well over 100 years old. It's got all the maker's marks there. And then you've got these sort of stereo cards with a double picture here. And when you look through it, it makes one image in three dimensions.
That is amazing.
With the original finishes having a retro quality, there was no need to update the interior design, but they certainly reinterpreted each area.
This is what became the dining room. It was originally a study, as you can see. It's got these high shelves, and this was a feature that we thought was incredible, this double volume space and these incredible shelving. So we thought, we can't waste it on being a study.
Yeah.
Lorna, I love this piece. It's another transformer piece, in fact. This opens up to be this incredible bar.
Wow.
It's a 1960s Scandinavian piece by a designer, which I also bought in an antique shop, in fact, in London. So this has become our whiskey tasting bar when we sit at the dining room table.
It feels quite small.
It does feel quite small. The space is contained. But what I enjoy is that we love to entertain. And sometimes we have small groups of people, which this table is perfect for. And when we're larger, this table pulls out on both sides. We can see 10 around here, which is wonderful for big parties.
I love it. Paul, that's quite a unique gallery of pictures. I'm sure there's an interesting story behind them.
Well, again, this house has spaces that you can discover, and you wouldn't notice that gallery unless you stood here or sat in these chairs.
Yeah.
And it's about the only space that you can see them.
As a child growing up in Joburg, Paul was fascinated by cities, the buildings within them, and how, over time, the design of each element informs the next. He goes to sleep and wakes up each day in his dream environment.
It's modern, it has a different feel to it, and it's also the way it opens to the outside is far more contained. And that's another clever thing about the architect is that the public spaces, the ones that get used by visitors and guests, are open, and in this space is much more of an enclosed, cozy sanctuary.
And I guess the choice of color does give this kind of calming feel.
Well, you know, here we've put some of our sort of interior decorating skills together. We both enjoy choosing colors and things. So you've got the sort of biscuit color on the walls, which goes with that art piece there. And then on the bed, we like to use grays and quite masculine colors.
The Rimpy Bench has a modern spin. And beyond being a bedroom, this is a comfortable reading spot too.
This room is fantastic because in winter we've got this wonderful fireplace. We can toast marshmallows from the bed.
Love it.
And when the weather's great, like in the mornings, we've got this wonderful space outside here where we can sit and drink a cup of coffee or our tea, read the morning newspaper and enjoy the outside and the sky.
Paul met his partner at university, and their shared philosophy and love of design is a major reason for the 18-year success of their relationship. It's a lesson in life, love, architecture, and more.
It's a lovely outdoor space. The sun shines here. You've got a lot of greenery around you and the birds chirping in the trees, so we really love it.
Paul, what was the most exciting part about putting this home together?
We like our home to evolve with us. Even though we see it as a design, it doesn't change, it grows with you. Finding a home for our collection of goods, the things that we've collected over the years, really was the most exciting thing, and making it work, making it into a modern home, even though they're old pieces.
The perception can be that antiques are boring and a little expensive as well.
Antiques or vintage items are very modern, in fact. You can have old pieces. You can have modern pieces, and I think the clever thing is to have fun collecting them, mix different styles, find a language that suits you, and have fun with it.
Well, you've definitely taught me a thing or two how antiques can be fun and inexpensive. Congratulations on your beautiful new home.
The 80s had a reputation for excess in fashion, but redeems itself in architecture.
Now, this is a home that gives new meaning to the phrase, something old, something new.
Up next, Thando Thabethe ensures that whatever the guys do, the girls still win. And honesty builds bridges between fathers and sons.
Ready to shoot some hoops? Thanks to a nudge from actress and 5FM presenter Thando Thabethe, a diverse group of women and even a few local celebrities committed to celebrating Women's Day with a little bit of healthy competition for a good cause.
Now in its third year, Thando Thabethe's Netball Challenge promotes the voice and power of women while celebrating their strides and efforts.
She's affectionately known as Thando Thabethe, but like most of us, we like to call her Tabuti following the success of her radio show. She's hosting her annual Women's Day Netball Challenge, and who knows, she might teach me a few things about catching a ball, because all these ballet hands know how to do is that.
Addressing issues from abuse of women and children to the role of women in the economy, Thando has chosen a popular and active way to spread the word.
Thando, this is such an amazing initiative. Why netball?
I don't know. For me, this is the sport I loved when I was in school. This is the sport for me that sort of kind of represented women for most of my childhood. And when I thought woman and I thought sport, I thought netball. So I thought, let's bring it alive and let's do something about it.
It's always fun to see a couple of celebrities trying to play netball. How do you think that's going to play out?
Every year the guys win. So this year we're going to bring it.
Your challenge today. The Thando Thabethe challenge is to teach Lorna a little bit of netball. Let's see how it goes.
The Take Back Your Power campaign has the support of achievers like Lillian Dube, Sophie Ndaba, and Unati Msengana. And as important, guys like DJ Fresh, John Mameza, and Somizi Mhlongo.
You know what, Somizi, having you here, I just know that the netball game has gone from here to there. But then the next question would be, what do you know about netball?
Lorna, I've been playing netball since high school, so you can imagine how excited I was to get this invitation. I was here last year. We killed it. Milkshake and the other guys, we murdered the girls. So this year when I got the invitation, I was like, great stuff, I'm looking forward to it. But shame, I feel sorry for the poor girls because we jump higher, we run faster, we talk the loudest, we scream the loudest, we do everything bigger. So I'm like, ooh, bring it on, girls. But we will see. But I'm like so excited to be here.
Kamu, you played a game last year. You're playing again this year. How are you feeling the women are going to do?
Well, last year we lost because I'll tell you why. Guys were not playing netball. They were actually playing basketball. Your Somizis, your Milkshake. So, well, we didn't win. But I'm hoping this year I've got a strong team. I've got Kanya, I've got Ayanda Thabethe, I've got Thando Thabethe. So, yeah, we're ready.
Why is it important to celebrate initiatives like this?
I think for me it's more important purely because I am what I am because of the woman in my life. And my mother and my two sisters are an example of strength throughout their entire life and the things they've kind of come up against. And if you're going to be fighting woman abuse and you're fighting the abuse of women and children, then be part of the process where you bring light to it and the fight against it.
The thing that she's doing, I think it's one of a kind and it's a good thing. And also the guys just to come in and get out of their comfort zone and just really spend the day with the girls, it's amazing and she's doing a good thing.
So there's always a rivalry against the guys and the girls with this netball challenge. Who do you think is going to win this year?
Firstly, I've been avoiding this netball challenge for the last 2 years. And then Thando got a hold of me beginning of the year and said, listen, I'm booking you now for August. So I'm here and I'll find out. Listen, I think the guys will win. On the basis that we are hard workers and we refuse to be beaten by women at a women's sport. That's how competitive guys are. I'm worried that guys like Milkshake are going to be tripping women. Don't trip women, not in netball, but I think we'll win.
I think the guys are definitely going to cheat and blame it on not knowing the rules, but doing it on purpose. But I think it's going to be a lot of fun. And a lot of guys underestimate netball. They don't see it as a real sport. So I think we're going to show them how it's actually done. And less of that basketball noise and more netball.
Milkshake, so everybody I've spoken to keeps telling me that you're going to do this, you're going to do that. You've played this for the second time now, and apparently you've got quite a mean reputation. What's going on? Talk to me, brother. Talk to me.
No. I think I've become the enemy, and I just want to make a public service announcement to the ladies that I'm not the enemy. I just happen to like running around, and the guys have been winning, you know, for many years, and yeah, it's just sad that they've been winning on Women's Day, man. This is one of those. But shout out to the ladies. I hope you guys win, but kind of low-key hoping they don't.
The ladies had a war dance and battle cry. The guys were working on strategy. And once the action began, the flurry of green suggested this might be the girls' year.
That is horrific. I think we need to practice more. The guys are just faster. They're taller. They're bigger.
Look, I mean, the whole campaign is an amazing thing, and I think I congratulate Thando for doing it. And look, everyone came out in numbers to support this initiative, and I'm hoping that everyone at home is taking back their power, not just women, but men too.
It was, I think, the perfect way to celebrate Women's Day. It's men and women celebrating women, and that's what today was all about.
Thando Thabethe has just turned 26, and the action and funds she's raised are an inspirational message to every member of the fairer sex.
Clearly netball isn't for sissies, and neither is Lorna. To really get to know the leads of a local coming-of-age film called My Father's War, she joined them to get down and dirty on a Special Forces survival camp.
This Magaliesberg camp is run by former Special Forces and police operators who now provide tactical and technical advice to the film industry.
Right, so we'll do a bit of a competition, and for that, we four people will do the classic Special Forces two-person team event.
Right, excellent. Two longs together, okay. And two shorts together.
Yay!
All I'm
going to say is that I'm extremely competitive. Do not let my size put you under anything, okay? Okay.
Lorna was paired with former Sjöndalen actor Stian Baum.
There are a lot of war movies that we see, but what's special about this one is that it's a heart story.
The big thing about this movie, it's actually a family drama. It's a drama about a father and son relationship and something that's not healing and trying to understand the other.
Well, Stian, I must tell you, I'm so happy I'm in your team. Hopefully you'll show me one or two things that you learned.
Yeah, let's see.
Done in an easygoing, informative way, these exercises were a window into the film subject, about a veteran of South Africa's border war and his struggle to relate to his son.
You have been captured. You are going to break out of your restraints. You're going to run for at least 20 meters behind you. On your way, literally 3 meters behind you, you'll see some survival essential equipment. Consider you must build a shelter and you must make a fire.
Jokes about their time in basic training before going to the border is about as much as most veterans will share around this troubled time in our history. So this was a way to break the ice on the subject.
Okay. Great, I think this is a wonderful spot, eh?
Okay.
Nice and sheltered. I'll start with a fire.
Okay. All right. Cool.
Yeah, let's make it here.
Stian, I'm gonna
I'm gonna leave you. I'm gonna love you and leave you. I've lost all kinds of cuteness. I'm in the bush. My nails are dirty. My lashes are have had enough. I'm gonna go check how the other boys are doing.
Can I have the knife?
Good luck.
The chemicals, thank you.
Bye.
The competition were ahead.
Where are they? I see them. Come, come, come. We got this, brother.
There's a point here, there's a point here.
The stars had clearly learned a lot on set.
I can't believe how far you guys have gotten.
Yes, we know.
And your fire's done. How did you guys do that?
You know why we are up ahead of this.
What do you mean? don't even go there. Fumani, your character is quite key in Edwin discovering his relationship with his dad. Tell me a bit about that.
We would sit as actors and be like, guys, what do you think? How do I pitch it? Where should I pitch it? That helped in terms of relationships, and when you watch it as an audience, you become part of this journey, because it's that, it's actors, directors coming together, working in one space and one understanding of what you're trying to create.
We had time to actually kind of pinpoint the relationship, special things in a relationship that actually becomes real truthful, and we wanted to depict that actually, you know, because a family, it needs to be real. There's other stuff, you know, feelings, and you don't always shout at each other, you know, and there's sometimes when you play on each other's nerves, you know what makes my dad tick, so you'll go for that. So it was nice finding that little things
and,
in a relationship.
And he did it.
Brings such sadness to my heart that you guys have the first challenge in the bag.
This is the theme until the end.
Personal experience is key to the film's plot. The son's nightmares about being in the war help him to relate to his father. But perhaps the stars have had enough first-hand experience for now.
Fumani, are you okay? You look a little bit on the shaking side.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
I've got issues.
See, Stian brought the shaking. Through the tears,
eh? Oh, yeah.
Listen, this challenge, guys, I give you this challenge. You can win it.
I love a man who gives it away that easily. Thank you very much. This is ours, buddy.
It was as brave a decision for these actors and filmmakers to attempt this film as it is to walk down a cliff backwards. The war is highly contentious, but the way the writing and directing handles it as a relationship makes it a human, not a political film. Lorna vowed to see it as soon as she was safely back on the ground.
Gentlemen, clearly Mac's not here, so we're going to have to adjudicate ourselves to see who the winners are for this particular challenge. Well, no, that's too soon.
Yep.
But
I'm sorry, I did a backflip on top of the thing and lost the GoPro, so sorry.
Sorry,
they do have
Stian,
to
tell them,
yes, Stian, no.
You should have told them that was a stunt. You were supposed to.
No, I went back too far. And I attempted, I think it's the Rio Olympics here.
But how amazing was that experience for you?
Amazing. No, at first it wasn't amazing at all. It was scary. Oh, I went over the edge. Wow. As I was going down, like, can I do this? Hey, I did this, I went down the mountain.
I think the person that learned the most was Stian today. he knows what not to do after today, but yeah, it was lovely, eh? Really enjoyed it. Can't believe we actually did it.
Why is My Father's War such a relevant film to us right now?
It focuses on a time period in our history that is very relevant, and right now, actually, you know, it was a few years ago. So everybody still sit with the scars, and I think because there wasn't enough healing, this movie can bring quite a lot of healing.
I think it's an honest film, and I think that's the beauty for me for the film. It's the family, especially the family scenes, is portrayed honestly, and we actually took a lot of effort to make it as honest as possible.
Soldiers, I had such a good time with you guys. I think it's time to head back to base camp. Ready?
You know.
Yeah.
Careful now. Careful.
That looks like a must-watch movie. And Lorna, respect. You can be my gym buddy anytime.
Still in store tonight. Bonang's dining out in Manhattan. Tears of the best kind flow at Siya Kolisi's wedding. But first, how DJ Nick Hamman and Mad Money Mike made the big time and let their feet do the talking.
Are you ready for a little nostalgia with 5FM's Nick Hamman and his producer Mad Money Mike? They're going back to Stellenbosch in true top billing style to revisit the town where they both got their start.
All right, that about does it for Hamman Time today. Go out and live your life. Don't do anything I wouldn't do, and if you do, name it after me. We'll see you tomorrow between 8 and 10. I need to get out of here. Mad Money Mike has been begging me to scrub my feet for the past week and a half, and finally, I've reluctantly allowed him to do it. So let me go warm up the water, and dip them toes in Mad Money's bath.
The 25-year-old Cape Town-born DJ is one of the station's rising stars. As with his first gig on campus radio, the appeal of his 8 to 10 morning show is about substance with style. He's studied politics, philosophy, he's a drummer, DJ, reads prolifically, and it all combines to make him someone you want to listen to.
You guys have come full circle. I mean, this is where the journey began.
It's pretty surreal being back here. I mean, this is the room that I used to host my show in. This is the room that Michael used to shout at me in because he was my boss when everything, you know, started. But it feels good and healthy to go back to your roots.
Mike, this is where you and Nick met. How's your relationship grown over the years?
Nick was spectacular when he came here. From the get-go, I knew, okay, cool, there's something we need to sort of nurture and grow here. It was less than 6 months, I think, and he was doing a drive-time show. And I think a lot of the guys here now kind of still see Nick as someone that, you know, if you really want to push yourself and if you've got the talent and you put in the hard work, you can do it.
You guys have some cool topics on your show. The other day you were asking your listeners, what are some of the items they cherish the most? But what I want to know is, what are some of yours?
Well, nostalgia has always been a big part of our show because we, as individuals, are both very nostalgic people, and we often like to share the story of where we came from personally and then encourage other people to do the same thing. The topic we had recently was, what item do you cherish the most in life? One guy told us about how he has a hard drive that has photos on it, which are some of the only memories he has left of some family members, to people who still carry the first beer can their father ever gave them. And when I thought about it myself, I actually bought something with today. This over here is an MTN radio award. It's the first one that I ever won in 2012, and it's the first award I ever got in radio. So the man who actually ended up judging this category, Best Campus Drive Show, was also at the time the program manager of 5FM, a man by the name of Tim Zunkel. And after hearing me there, he gave me a call, and sometime later I ended up with my dream job.
So mine's a bit of a different take to my memorabilia. I think if it comes to something that's kind of helped me through any times, and from as early as I can remember, I've had this little guy with me since I was born, basically. It was my mom's just before. And yeah, wherever I stay, it's there. And it's kind of helped through tough times, good times. You know, when you bring anyone over, they always love to see that you've got a cute little bear. It's always a plus.
Nick's radio content looks set to make him a classic in his field. His ideas are of his own design, so we laid on a ride befitting such an original.
And seeing that we're taking it way back, I think it's fitting that we roll around in this beautiful classic. What do you think?
This is beautiful. It's a lot nicer than the cars we drive now, I'll tell you that much.
It's awesome.
Quentin, what's happening, man? You're going to take us through the specs of this car.
This is a 1958 Jaguar Mark 8. This car was manufactured only between 1956 and 1958, and there were only about 6,000 of them made.
I don't know about you, but I'm always interested to see what's under the hood.
Let's pop that thing open.
Pop the hood, man!
This is a 3.4-litre straight-six Jaguar motor, capable of producing 170 brake horsepower and a top speed of 190 k's an hour.
I'm guessing it's quite heavy on fuel.
It is very heavy on fuel, but funny enough, this car actually won an economy run in Australia in 1958. These particular cars were also used for rallying, believe it or not, and Rowan Atkinson actually had a similar model that he raced around in the UK.
Can we test it out?
Sure, definitely. But before we do, I've got a little gift for you guys, something a little bit more suitable for the car.
To be a class act, you need to start young and build a repertoire. As an entertainer, Nick was already a jazz drummer, playing in clubs at the age of 14. At 16, he started jamming with bands on the indie scene. He began moving between hip-hop, house, rock, and punk, arriving at university as quite a polished act.
Stellenbosch for me was like the first of so many things in life. I had my first girlfriend here, I had my first failed course here, got my first job here. It's one of the most beautiful places in the world, and there we are stuck in Johannesburg making radio every day.
Well, that's where it all started. I mean, radio, the love for it was right here. And Stellenbosch has so many special memories for me, for Nick, and I couldn't imagine anywhere else.
You know, speaking of firsts, Michael was also my first boss, and I remember when I met him, I was really nervous. I thought that he was going to be a strict, like, disciplinarian. I think he was in the beginning. Like, I was intimidated by him, and it's really weird to think that we work together now, because I put so much value and emphasis into impressing him, which is probably what helped me get good as quickly as I did as well.
In the music field, Nick is a versatile producer and DJ with a decade of experience. Whatever the venue, performing comes naturally. And he found a creative way to incorporate live elements into his set. With pads, controllers, and live drumming, he became as popular at student gigs as beer and pizza.
You guys come up with some fantastic ideas, but how exactly do you come up with your content?
The best part about what we do is when the listeners get involved. They love it. They send voice notes to the Hammer Time hotline daily, and it's great to be a part of their lives as much as they are a part of ours with what we do on air.
Some company sent us a gift recently, and in that gift packet was a little laser, which is like the worst thing you can send a 12-year-old or Mad Money Mike. Well, he's basically acting like a girl. Now, he's gonna shine it in my eyes, and he thinks that it's funny. But you know what, Michael? It's not funny, because next thing you know, what's gonna happen is I'm gonna get a serious injury. I'm not gonna be able to see, which might actually heighten my other senses now that I think about it.
The biggest adventure to date was when the guys found themselves on the R101 between Auckland Park and Polokwane.
One of those fantastic ideas was the Polokwane walk.
5FM came to us and they said, we want you to create hype around a big party we were having in Polokwane. So I jokingly was like, Mike, let's walk there. We were both laughing and joking and laughing, and then we were on the road. And we started walking, and it was 2 weeks, about 25 kilometers a day, waking up at 6 in the morning. It's the most intense working environment that you could ever imagine two people being in. We got lost one day, which was Mike's fault, 100%. We met, though, this is the beautiful side of it, so many South Africans on the way, slept in treetop tents, camped off on the side of the road, and we would have people who would drive 120, 150, 200 kilometers sometimes just to bring us water or beer or just, even once we had a guy who came just to say hi, and that's what made the whole thing so incredible for us. We felt like Forrest Gump.
For the listeners, I think, you know, for them, it was about following a journey with two people that they sort of got to care about. And in terms of like the time that it was over the 2 weeks, I think at the end of it, a lot of people still come up to us to this day and say like, you know, we loved that walk. Did you walk that far? You know, how much did you do every day? Like, how do you still like each other? Don't you hate each other? They were very involved. And I think for them, for those 2 weeks, that was their own little story that they got involved in.
Well, you guys know that South Africa loves you and you have a lot of fans, but what can they expect from you in the future?
We just want to continue doing what we love. And we honestly believe that if we do that every day, people are going to continue to love us and our audience is going to continue to grow.
That it will, especially in a few weeks' time when they release their latest theme song featuring The Plastics, Majorzi, Raven, Grassy Spark, and Mr. Jack Parrow himself. You heard it here.
There's nothing like a walk down memory lane. Especially when you've got something epic like a walk to Polokwane to reminisce about.
Coming up, supermodel Andrea Diakonu brings you Spring 16 from New York City with photographer Margaret Tsang and Bonang.
International model Andrea Diakonu is the new face of Woolworths Studio.W. Being based in the Big Apple, Andrea gave Bonang the inside scoop of all her favorite places to go in New York. Let's go join them behind the scenes to find out more.
Studio W is synonymous with urban life. With that comes style, travel, and discovering new cities. And what better place to do this than New York? We joined the team behind the scenes on their Spring-Summer 2016 campaign shoot.
Thank you. I'm here to interview the brand new face of Studio W to find out what she loves most about New York City. Follow me.
Supermodel Andrea Diakonu is very familiar with the jet set life, having walked the runway for the likes of Chanel, Marc Jacobs, and Prada. She's also been the face of top luxury brands from Balmain to Gucci. This Studio W collection is the perfect capsule wardrobe for the urban lifestyle. Monochrome pieces mixed with pops of print in easy-wearing fabrics make for an ultra-chic look, modeled with style by Andrea.
Now, at the age of 25, you are a supermodel with so many achievements under your belt. Can you tell me how it feels to be so successful at such a young age?
Thank you for that. And great, I wake up every morning and I'm like, yay, I'm so lucky. I'm gonna stretch out and rule the world. No, it's amazing. I'm very, very, very lucky.
What do you love about, you know, the Big Apple?
I love all my friends here, and everyone's like very curious, and it's fast-paced, so it can either give you anxiety or it can make you very productive. So I guess it depends what kind of person you are.
A couple of rapid, quick-fire questions. Your favorite coffee shop in New York?
Everyman Espresso.
Your favorite place to shop?
Mass Bookstore.
Your favorite place to grab lunch?
Bouvet.
Your favorite New York snack?
Pretzels.
After a very long day, your favorite place to grab a drink or a cocktail?
Right. Restaurant?
All right, one last thing. You speak five languages. I know you are Romanian, so can you say, hi, I'm Andrea. Thank you very much for spending the day with me. Mm-hmm. Enjoying New York in Romanian, in there.
Okay. Salut, sunt Andrea și mă bucur că am petrecut azi împreună. Sper să vă distrați în continuare în New York.
That's
so weird. So weird to speak my own language.
I know, right? After such a long time. Well, I'm going to allow you to get back to the shoot. Congratulations. Okay. Welcome to the WooWords family.
Thank you.
And enjoy the rest of your shoot.
Thank you.
While Andrea does that, you and me are going to take a bite out of the Big Apple.
Armed with Andrea's hot list of what to do in New York, Bonang hailed one of the trademark canary yellow cabs and headed off to see where the fashion set hang out. First stop, craft coffee shop, Everyman Espresso.
Right, summer in New York, I'd usually go for a sexy cappuccino, but I think an iced latte would be perfect. Andrea knows her coffee. Off to spot number two.
This area of New York is Andrea's backyard, a historically creative hub and home to many artists and writers. It's also the location of the next stop on her hot list, Mast Books, a regular with local fashionistas.
I see why Andrea loves this bookstore. It has a great selection of curated books. Looking around, I mean, it really celebrates the history and artistry of Lower East Side New York.
Spot number three on the list is Chef Jody Williams' Buffet Gastrotech, an old world cafe that's Andrea's favorite brunch spot.
Buffet is a French-style gastrotech, the perfect place for friends and family together for a quick bite or some drinks. This good madame is magnifique.
For a lazy afternoon on a hot summer's day in Manhattan, Central Park is the best place to grab a pretzel, Andrea's top New York City snack. For dinner with a touch of class, her spot number four is Freud. It offers a contemporary take on brasserie fare, inspired by turn-of-the-century Vienna, but in the heart of Greenwich Village. The dishes are created by Austrian Michelin star chef, Eduard Fraunader.
An awesome afternoon in New York City, courtesy of Andrea. Thank you so much. Tomorrow, she's promised a very special shoot with an awesome photographer in a wonderful location. Can't wait for that.
Time to get some beauty sleep before the shoot with one of Business of Fashion's top 500 most influential people in fashion, photographer Margaret Zhang, whose lens was aimed at Andrea.
Another day, another shoot in New York City on the roof. How do you feel?
I'm incredibly excited to be up on a roof because most of them don't allow that. So that in itself, it's like a very exciting New York City moment. And I'm excited that you guys are back and we're gonna have a great cloudy day together.
Now, being so successful at such a young age, are there any career highlights, one particular moment that stands out for you?
I always think that I'm just so incredibly grateful to be working every day, so I can't highlight necessarily one moment. But every time I get called in for a job, I'm like, oh, okay, great.
With an Instagram following of 800,000, Margaret is well known for her style and attention to detail.
You are a multi-talented, multifaceted woman. What else do you do?
So I do a bit of everything. It's very mixed bag. No 2 days are the same. So I do a lot of freelance consulting, working with, you know, anything from like a startup to a huge international corporations. Do a lot of freelance photography, mainly fashion photography. And then freelance styling often goes hand in hand with my photography. So like today, I'm shooting and styling it. Yeah, it's super mixed bag. I travel a lot. Very lucky to move around so much and work with so many different people every day.
And of course, today we're on set with Studio.W and WooWords. Tell me a little bit more about the shoot.
Yeah, so today we're shooting a Studio.W story with amazing campaign face Andrea. She's obviously, you know, like by all means a huge supermodel and she's so beautiful, so I'm really excited to shoot her on this amazing rooftop in New York. This is a really great opportunity and I'm really excited.
When Studio.W and WooWords approached you, what exactly was the brief?
they just really wanted me to, you know, shoot Andrea like as she is really naturally, have me kind of style key Studio.W pieces into, you know, what I would personally style somebody in and what Andrea would necessarily wear. And just to show like the versatility of the pieces because they are very versatile. We've worked together previously shooting Joan Smalls for the previous campaigns, so that's really awesome. I mean, it's like a great continuation and I love working with them.
It's a wrap, finally. How do you feel?
I'm very excited. I can't wait to see it finished.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. I had a very good time in New York, and that list is amazing.
I'm glad to hear that. Hope everyone gets to try it.
Yeah, I definitely took a bite out of the Big Apple, so thank you.
Love the fashion? Get Studio W Summer 16 collection in-store and online now at woolworths.co.za.
If that first glance was anything to go by, this season's Studio W collection is going to be super chic and fit for any city. Visit the Woolworths website and tell us which three Studio W items are on your fashion wish list, and you could stand a chance of winning a Woolworths gift card to the value of 2,500 rand.
Still to come, the proposal was hair-raising, but to the guests, Siya Kolisi and Rachel Smith's wedding was one of the weddings of the year.
When rugby superstar Siya Kolisi decided to walk down the aisle with his beloved bride Rachel Smith, it wasn't just the pinnacle of a four-year romance. It's also the tale of a now unified family brought together by love.
The couple met in Stellenbosch 4 years ago and returned to wine country for their wedding. Amongst the groomsmen were best man Nick Holton, childhood friends, and Sia's rugby teammates.
Hi guys!
Hey!
I feel like I'm in the locker room with the boys.
I've got an extra shirt for you, so you can feel part of the boys.
Thank you. Should I put on now?
Yeah, put on now. Yeah.
Okay.
She's one of us boys. Are you?
Thank you. Scurry, is Sia always this relaxed?
Sia's a big clown in the group, you know. Paulie's having fun, a lot of banter when Sia's around, and we had a chat last night. And yeah, he's flipping excited for later on this afternoon. So yeah, and we all can't wait. We're so excited for him.
Could you take us through the proposal from the planning to the execution?
We had a deal. We said we want to see who's more romantic. And I thought, you know, because I started the whole thing, because I always said I'm more romantic than her. So I played out the whole thing.
And he came home from training the one day with a huge bunch of flowers and made me breakfast in bed and told me to pack a bag. So I packed my bag and I was like, oh, it's fine. He probably got like a hotel where we can stay for the night, which is cool. I can still top that.
I took her to the helicopter because she'd never been to a helicopter range. So we went in a helicopter. It's also my first time. I was very scared because I'm scared of heights.
And halfway through, he was like holding on the sides and he was like, I hate this. This is terrible. Put me down. And we ended up staying up, and then the helicopter stopped in front of Table Mountains, one of the most beautiful views in the world.
And then I pulled out the ring. She obviously knew, and I don't remember what I said to her. I just remember forcing the ring, and it was in, and you just keep on pushing. She was like, yes, yes. So it was pretty awesome.
You come from very humble beginnings. Did you ever imagine having a wedding like this?
No, I didn't at all. You watched weddings on TV, and then you're like, I want a wedding like that. And I told her, and she actually wanted a small wedding. She said she didn't mind if it's just the two of us and we get married. She didn't want anything big, but I said, I want to go big. And because it was my last wedding, so I just want to go big. And it is my last wedding. First and last wedding.
Well, there's not going to be much dancing happening with that foot of yours.
Well, that's what the doctor said. I love dancing, you know. I love dance to all sort of music. So tonight I'm going to have to try and make a way to dance with my fiance. I have to give her a first dance, you know. Even if it's a couple of seconds, but I'll do my best.
Rachel would be a vision in French Chantilly lace and Italian tulle.
Rachel was incredibly easy. She came to us sort of not really knowing what she wanted. But she was so easy to speak to. By the time we'd finished talking, she was happy, we were happy, and at every fitting she just got happier and happier.
Black bridesmaids dresses, that's different.
Yes, so the decision behind the black bridesmaids' dresses was that we wanted to keep things nice and contrasted, and also with Siya being black and myself white, we wanted to sort of keep the theme and not have any random colors like pink or purple or anything like that. And then, yeah, all my bridesmaids are tall and beautiful, so I thought it would fit them well.
The two of you have adopted Sia's siblings and have a child together. What does this wedding day mean for your little family?
It's huge for us. I mean, it's a good example, I think, firstly, that we're going to be sitting for the kids, but it is a big step forward for all of us, you know, and yeah, it's going to be good for them because it's just the matter of security and stuff, I think, that it'll bring for everyone, so... Oh yeah, I'm all excited.
And having them there with you?
When I was shopping for Nick's suit, our son actually, I was so excited and happy, and you can't really explain the feeling unless you're getting married and you have a child, but like just that you can shop for your son and know that he's actually going to be there with you on that day is just incredible.
What is it about Siya that made you say yes to the ring?
There are so many things about Siya that I absolutely adore. But if I were to name a few, definitely the fact that he's so patient. He absolutely loves his kids, and that was the biggest thing for me and what I love the most. I mean, what woman doesn't like a man that loves kids?
Thabethe, your sister and Siya are both beautiful inside and out. What is it about them that complement one another?
Their playfulness together, that they don't let everything that's surrounding them get to them, that they keep it real with each other, they love each other, they love their family. That's their main focus is around the family, and that's what makes them strong.
Siya's dedication to rugby took him out of Swede Township into a life in first-class sport, and it brought his bride into his life.
So Siya, normally this emotional?
No, Sia's not really an emotional guy, but I think seeing the love of your life coming down the aisle, any man will get emotional. But yeah, I wish them all the best for the marriage, and I'm really looking forward to the rest of the night.
Ashley, isn't this just the most beautiful winter wedding?
Oh my goodness, it is so stunning, and Rachel looks so amazing. She's the most beautiful bride I've ever seen.
I'm so happy for them, you know, that they've come through some real tough patches with Sia's schedule, you know, traveling and things like that, and Rachel's had to look after little Nick and Sia's brother and sister that also live with them. So it hasn't been the easiest journey for them, but Rachel's always stood by Sia's side and really solidified that relationship, and I'm just so happy for them that they've had this special day and we can all be a part of it.
Pat, you and Siya have been teammates, you've been rivalries, but today you're his supporter.
Yes, very much so. Known Siya coming on 10 years now, played with and against him for most of my career from school days. Very happy for Siya and Rachel. It's been a wonderful day so far. The rain's a blessing, and I think it's going to be an even more wonderful evening ahead.
Most of the 200 guests stayed for the weekend sharing stories. It's well known that Rachel was at first unsure about Siya. They became friends, he then confessed his feelings, and it wasn't long before she admitted the same.
Aisha, from one sports wife to another sports wife, what advice would you give for their marriage?
I think it's very challenging to manage the schedules that we have to go through with our husbands. So to the happy couple, I would just say to work on the relationship, work on the romance when they're traveling. And when Rachel's without Siya, you know, just keep that fire alive. That's the most challenging bit. Other than that, I'm so happy for them, and I know they're going to be so happy together.
Beast, how do you know the couple?
Obviously, I've been very fortunate to play rugby with Siya since 4 years back at the Springbok level. And I think I've watched Siya grow as a person, and now firstly becoming a parent, and now eventually getting married. So really proud of the guy, you know, he's a stand-up guy.
Rachel's been there for everything, from Sia's initiation to when he played in the World Cup. Watching them dance, his father has witnessed how far his son has come since the time when even a meal every day was by no means guaranteed. His success has been life-changing.
I can honestly say this has been one of the most heartfelt and touching weddings I've ever been to. What have been some of your highlights?
The ceremony, obviously we got married, and Pastor Phil was amazing, and it was very emotional for us. So, I mean, it's a big step for us, and we've had a long road together. And Sia's speech was just incredible, and the things he said about me and stuff were just, it's beautiful.
And for you, Siya?
Just seeing family and friends come together, people that have never met each other, and my brother and sister seeing what this life is about, you know, something I never had, they can experience it so that one day they can also aim high and not aim low and think that they can have no dreams, yeah.
Well, Mr. and Mrs. Kolisi, congratulations to the both of you and all the best for you and your beautiful family.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Between family life and career, Sia's great passion is transforming rugby, putting meals on the plates of young players, building facilities, and giving others a chance to play their way into a good life.
A beautiful wedding indeed. Now, in the same way that Siya Kolisi has honored his wife, I hope we've all honored the special woman in our lives this Women's Month and going forward. Until next Thursday, it's good night and God bless.
Next week, Mishka Partipal pokes fun at reality TV royalty in Keeping Up with the Kandasamis. Designer Laddu Mangogolo greets spring with pastel golf shirts and crew necks, while High Rollers celebrates a wedding, assuming no one rocks the boat.